Same family, but new owner.
See my attorney tomorrow.
There you go.
So we continue in the believer's armor tonight, and previously we had discussed how Satan uses discouragement to defeat us. Another tool that he uses is doubt in the life of a Christian. What is it that Christians doubt?
Their salvation sometimes.
Sometimes they doubt their salvation. Okay.
Losing their salvation.
Losing your salvation. Yeah. I know I've talked to people in counseling who told me that they had sinned so grievously that they felt they had lost their salvation. And I spoke to them quite a bit about that. But you know, when you do mess up, do you ever hear Satan whisper in your ear that telling you how can you be a Christian when you do stuff like that? You know, how can you allow yourself to think you're a Christian? You better try all over again. And all that is it's just the idea of planting a seed of doubt. He wants you to doubt the promises of God, because the promises of God are pretty clear in this area, and we're going to go ahead and look at those in your outline. So when you have those kind of doubts, all you have to do is put on your helmet of salvation. Remember, we've talked about the helmet of salvation, that your helmet of salvation is really an instrument of your daily walk. And you have to realize then, you have to dwell on the idea that you have been saved, that you are being saved, and you will be saved, okay? In regards to glorification. You have been saved, you're walking in sanctification, and eventually you'll be glorified. So the first verse we have tonight is John 6, 37 through 40. And this is one of the best verses in the Bible in regards to the security of the believer. And John 6, 37 through 40 says, all that the Father gives me will come to me, and the one who comes to me I will by no means cast out. For I have come down from heaven, not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. This is the will of the Father who sent me, that of all he has given me, I should lose nothing, but should raise it up at the last day. And this is the will of him who sent me, that everyone who sees the Son and believes in him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up at the last day. So the idea is here that there's three different types of security portrayed in those four verses. The first one is the decree that God secures you. The only ones who come to Christ are who? Are the ones given to him by the Father. Okay? Those are the ones that come to Christ. All right? The second security you have in those verses is the response of Jesus Christ. If we take Jesus at his words there, there's no circumstances. There's nothing present in the universe where Jesus can cast out somebody who has come to him. Okay? So if you've earnestly come to the Father, then you can't lose your salvation. This is because all of those who come to him are really, the way I was taught back when I was a Southern Baptist, is that they are really love gifts from the Father. The ones that God gives to Christ are love gifts from God to his Son. And then the other way that you are secure is that the will of the Father secures you. Okay? It is the will of the Father that all those that he gives to Christ, that he would not lose any of those, and then that they would all be raised up on the last day. So I know, and remember, the one thing about that whole panorama is that you did nothing for any of that, okay? So listen to me. If you did nothing to earn any of that, how can you do anything? You do anything to lose that when you didn't do anything to begin with, okay? It is a gift. So it has to be understood as a gift. The Son loves the Father too much to ever lose anyone that the Father would give him. So the whole idea, see, the security of the believer really is a idea that's wrapped up in the Trinity. It's a process by the Father and the Son. They are the foundation, and the Holy Spirit, who convicts, is the action part of the picture. Okay, so salvation is really wrapped up in the Trinity, is the way I like to think about it. Go a little bit further in John, and go down to John 10. John 10:27 through 30. This is in the old time vernacular. These are known as the seven strands, okay, of security. This is the way it used to be taught a lot of years ago. And you know me, I like to go back and look at the way that people used to teach, but there's a lot of reasons why they used to teach that way before liberalism entered the church. But in John 10:27, it says, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me, and I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one." Okay? So the first strand is the character of the shepherd. Okay? The character of the shepherd. If we are, as we are described here, as Christ's sheep, it is his duty as the shepherd to do what? What did shepherds do? They did two things. They cared for and protected the sheep. So Christ is our protector, and he cares for us. And we know what happens if Christ loses one sheep. He goes and gets it. He will not lose any. So the inference, and I used to, you know, I told you I had a Nazarene high school principal who believed in salvation law. I used to tell him, you know, when you say that people can lose their salvation, that's a slur against the name of Jesus. Boy, he'd get mad at me. You can't say that. So yeah, it's a slur, because Christ says that he's our shepherd. He's not going to lose any. The second strand, the first is the character of the shepherd. The second strand is the character of the sheep. Okay? Christ's sheep follow who? Him. That's right. The shepherd. There's no exceptions. The sheep, you can go, if you've got a, if, there's a, Arlene lent me a book. I've been reading about sheep and shepherds. And, you know, if a stranger walks up to a sheep herd and starts trying to lure them away, they don't even act as if they know he's a person. They pay absolutely no attention to them at all. So the second strand of these strands of our security is the character of the sheep. If we're really his sheep, we should only be listening to him, okay? And sheep do fall down, right? We do fall down. Yeah. Not quite like that. And it's the shepherd's character that draws us to him, and then he cares and protects us, and because we are his children, we follow him. The third strand The third strand is the definition of eternal life. The sheep, as you read in the verses, I give them, it says, eternal life. The definition of the sheep are given eternal life, and how long? So if Jesus Christ gives people eternal life, how long is that? It's a long time. It's eternally, okay? And that's part of what we have to be so grateful for. So to speak of the gift of eternal life ending is a contradiction in terms. It really is, okay? The fourth strand is the definition of the gift. Eternal life is a gift. I give eternal life. The idea is you didn't do anything to earn it, and you can't do anything, you know. Listen, if your losing of salvation is dependent upon your sinning, you would lose it every day. Would you not? I would. So it cannot be determined. And so then you have to say, well, what's the magnitude of sin that causes you to lose your salvation? I don't know. It's a hard position to defend, although my principal used to do it very well. The fifth strand is the truthfulness of Christ. The truthfulness of Christ. Christ said that his sheep would never perish, okay? So if Christ says that none of his sheep will perish, and they shall never perish, it says in verse 28, what would happen if one perished? That would mean Christ would be a liar. And Christ can't be a liar, okay? So if one person that was saved ended up in hell, you could throw away the whole Bible. Because it would no longer have any foundation. So when Christ says that none will perish, that's exactly what he means, okay? The sixth strand is the power of Christ. There's no power in the universe that's able to pick up a shepherd's sheep. Who's going to take you from Christ's hand? Mm-hmm. Nobody. And then the last one, the seventh strand, is the power of the Father. Who's going to take you from God's hand? So, and really the thought is, you are in Christ's hand, and that hand is in your Father's hand. So who's opening up those hands? Nobody's opening up those hands. Look at Romans 8, 38 and 39. When you find it, somebody read it for us.
For I am persuaded that neither death nor life nor angels nor principalities nor powers nor things present nor things to come nor height nor depth nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord.
The idea... Paul paints a very broad picture. None of this stuff, none of these things can separate us from the love of God. Philippians 1:6. Somebody read that for us.
Being confident of this very thing, that he who has begun a good work in you.
Stop. He who has begun a good work in you. What's that mean? That's salvation. He's begun a good work in you. That's the past. Keep going, Larry.
He'll complete it.
That's it. Stop. So if he's going to complete it, he's going to complete it now. He's completing it now in the present. So go ahead.
Until the day of Jesus Christ.
That's it. When's that? That's the future. Past, present, future. All three aspects of salvation, all three elements of salvation in one verse. Turn back to the book of Jude, that little book of Jude. You know, the book of Jude is a short letter. It was written to a very small group of people. And it was written to a group of people who were in the, it was really what we would consider to be the apostate age. Not a lot different than it is today, really. And they saw, this group of people saw everything around them kind of going down the drain. Kind of like the church in Thessaloniki we're going to talk about Sunday night as we start in earnest to study what happens when we die. They saw everything going on down the drain, and they wondered what the future had for them. And so they received this book, this letter, so that they won't have fear, no matter how bad things around them appear to be. And in the second half of the first verse, he said, to those who are called, sanctified by God the Father, and preserved in Jesus Christ. Jude 1, okay? The second half of the first verse. So it says, to those who are called, the first thing I want to look at is in Jesus Christ. Actually, a better translation of the Greek is by Jesus Christ, preserved by Jesus Christ. And what that indicates in the Greek is that Jesus is the one who keeps and guards you, and he never relaxes you. There's the tense there indicates that this is an eternity of his preservation of you. And then the word, does anybody have a different translation? Does anybody have the word kept instead of preserved? Yeah. That word kept is from the Greek word tereo. And it means, again, the idea behind it is to preserve it, to watch it, to guard it. And it stresses the idea of being very, very watchful. And it denotes the idea of what is being watched is being watched. Now, who's Jesus watching? Us. Listen. What is being watched is being watched because it is a priceless treasure. That's the way Jesus watches over you. That's what that word means in the Greek. It's like the most precious treasure you have. That's the way Jesus sees you. That's the way he wants to preserve you. Now look at Jude 24. Okay? Jude 24. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with this exceeding joy. Okay? Is able. Now to him who is able. That's from the Greek word dunama. What word do we get from dunama?
Dynamite.
Dynamite. He is able to keep you. So the idea is he is able because of what? What's dynamite? It's powerful. He's able to keep you by his power. He's so powerful, he's able to keep you from falling. Okay? So is able to keep. Now, earlier we looked at kept as in tedio, but here, to keep is not the same word that's used back in verse 1. Here in verse 24, it's a different word. It's phulasso. P-H-U-L-A-S-S-O. Phulasso. Okay? And phulasso means to secure when you are under attack. To surround something and to secure it. So he's able to secure you, to keep you from stumbling. When you're under attack, he's able to secure you so you don't stumble. So up in the first verse of Jude, it says that he kept you as if you're a precious gift. He's watching over you. And here he's keeping you to secure you when you're being attacked. Okay? So he keeps a watchful eye on you, and he keeps a watchful eye out on your attackers. Both of them. And that's how he works with us. See, that's why when he moves in your life, it's so important to respond. Because he's moving for a reason. He knows what's going on. He knows who's attacking you, how they're attacking you spiritually. So it's so important for you to respond. And then when it says to keep you from stumbling, some versions will use the from falling. Literally, the Greek means stumbling. Somebody look up Psalm 121, 3. It should be.
He will know why your foot is moved. He will keep you from that slumber.
Yeah, he will not allow your foot to slip. It's better. It's the idea of stumbling. It's the same idea. Okay? And then how is he going to present you? He's going to present you faultless in Jude 24. Okay? Does anybody have another word besides faultless?
Blameless.
Huh?
Blameless.
Blameless. That's good. Anomos. 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 And anomos is a word it's a word that refers to sacrifices in the Old Testament. What was the animal that was sacrificed? What were they? They were blameless, without blemish. That's the way Jesus will present you to his Father. So the use of the word there is very, very specific. So it will call to the reader's mind, it will call to these people's mind the idea that he's going to make us like a sacrifice without a spot or a blemish. 1 Peter 1:18 and 19 uses the same term when it talks about Christ. You will be like Christ without spot or blemish. Okay? You have to be. You can't have sin because God's not going to allow sin. So Jude is a great little book. What he's saying, no matter what, all the host of, Satan, the demons, they can throw whatever they want against you, but Christ is power enough to keep you from falling, and he will present you as a spotless lamb, as Jesus, in the presence of God. Okay? Any thoughts on that? Okay. 23rd Psalm. The psalmist knew ultimately the idea in the second half of the sixth verse. It says that we will dwell in the house of God, or the house of the Lord, forever. Okay? Again, the idea of your security. And then 1 Thessalonians 5, and we're going to be all over the book of 1 Thessalonians Sunday night. But Paul says, this is the benediction of 1 Thessalonians 23 and 24, I think, are the last two. Well, no. This is the benediction, though. It says, now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. He who calls you is faithful, who also will do it. And then there's a closing. But that's the benediction of the book of 1 Thessalonians. That's Paul writes to the church in Thessaloniki about their confusion over death. So, to conclude this particular section then, when Satan comes with discouragement, as we've discussed earlier, and doubt, as we've discussed tonight, he assures, we need to be assured that we have victory. Our victory is coming one way or the other. Okay? Fight a good fight. Have confidence in your salvation. And then wait for one day you will be with your Father in heaven. And you will receive your rewards for the work you've done here for him on earth. Alright? So I want us to I want to start into a new section about, and we're gonna start on the last piece of armor. We may not get that far tonight, but the last piece of our armor is the sword of the Spirit, okay? What is the sword of the Spirit? The Word of God. There's a noted theologian named Guthrie who wrote that the Bible is an armory of heavenly weapons, a laboratory of infallible medicines, a mind of exhaustless wealth. It is a guidebook for every road, a chart for every sea, a medicine for every malady, a balm for every wound. And then he says, rob us of our Bible, and our sky has lost its sun. Most of you are familiar with John Wesley, okay? John Wesley, him and his brother, founders of the Methodist Church, although they don't recognize the church today. He said that the Bible must have been written by God, or by good men, or by bad men, or by angels, or by devils. Then he said that bad men and devils wouldn't write it because it condemns the bad men and the devils. Good men and angels wouldn't deceive men by lying as to its authority and claiming that God wrote it, and therefore the Bible has to have been written as it claims to have been written by God, okay? Whose Spirit inspired men to record God's words using the human instruments to communicate His truth, okay? So I want to look at Bible claims. The first one is that the Bible claims to be infallible. So, define infallible. Huh? No fault, okay. No error. Bible claims to be inerrant. Inerrant would be no error. We'll go infallible, no fault. Inerrant means no error. Proverbs 30 speaks to that, 5 and 6. Every word of God is, it says, pure. The Bible is complete, okay? Last Sunday night we studied Revelation 22. What happens if you add to the Bible? It says that the place of the book will be added to you. What happens if you take away from the Bible? It says that your name will be taken out of the book of life. Okay? So the Bible is complete. It's authoritative. That means that when God speaks, everybody should be listening. Okay? Isaiah 1:2, it says, hear, O heavens, and give ear, O earth, for the Lord has spoken. The Bible, now, in each one of these areas, modern society has attacked the Bible in each one of these areas. Its infallibility, its inerrancy. The Southern Baptist Convention was teaching in their seminaries 30, 40 years ago, there were professors teaching that God's word was errant, certain portions of it. People have attacked its completeness. The world has attacked its authoritativeness. That's why we don't use the Bible anymore as our source of truth, because the world has told us it's not true for everybody. All depends who you are, and we've allowed it to do that. Another thing that it's attacked is in regards to is to the sufficiency. In 2 Timothy 3:15 through 17, it says that the Bible is sufficient. It says it will make you wise unto salvation, and it will make you perfect, perfectly furnished unto all good works. The Bible will engineer within you good works. So the book can bring you to salvation, and ultimately it will bring you to glorification, which is perfection. And thus, you don't need anything else. The Bible is sufficient. You're supposed to be satisfied with Jesus. Did you know that? We used to sing that song, Satisfied with Jesus. You should be satisfied with Jesus. He's all you need. You don't need anything else. But people are continually looking for other things. And the world has told us that the Bible is no longer... that's how people can read things in the Word of God that says that this is a sin against God. And they can say, I'm going to go ahead and do it anyways because it doesn't matter anymore and I'm still going to go to church every week and be a Christian. How's that work? Happens all the time. Happens every week, every weekend. Another thing, the Bible is effective, okay? When the Bible speaks, things happen. The Word of God works for transformation, okay? Isaiah 55:11 speaks to that. The Word goes forth from my mouth, and it shall not return unto me void. The Word of God is effective. It shall accomplish what I please, is the way that ends. The Word of God is divine. The world has attacked the divinity of God's Word. 2 Peter 1:20-21 speaks about there's no prophecy of Scripture that is of any private interpretation. Okay? That means that there is no leeway in regards to the interpretation of God's Word. It says the holy men of God spoke it as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. So the Bible is God's book. It is divine. And the book, the last one is that the Bible is determinative in nature. Okay? And all that simply means is the Bible has two results. And the Bible, by itself, gives two definitive determinations. And it speaks the same. It doesn't change. But the determinations are damnation and salvation. Okay? There's nothing else. There's nothing else in between. So the Bible is determinative. In John 8:47, God said, he that hears the word of God, you have to listen to God's word or you'll perish. Okay? That's a paraphrase of 8:47. But if you listen to the Bible, it shows you that it will show you that you belong to God. And if you don't, it will show you, listen, the Bible will substantiate your salvation or it will substantiate your damnation. Because when I was lost, when I was a kid, I told you I used to read the Bible, but I read it like Revelation. I thought it was a great science fiction book. But I knew as I read it that I didn't know this God. That was not part of what I was reading it for. I was reading it for my own personal enjoyment. So, the Bible has everything to offer you. It has everything that you need if you'll only allow it to provide it to you. The Bible's like a big pot of resources. I used to like to make big pots of beef stew and put all these vegetables and stuff in there. A lot of stuff and a lot of resources in there. Well, the Bible is full of resources. It has everything you need. The first thing it has is truth. And you know what society needs today? It needs truth. Because everybody has their own truth. You know, everybody gets to decide what the truth is. And that's how we end up with all these peculiarities in regards to the truth. John 17:7 says, thy word is truth. Okay? Everything. It tells you the truth about God's relationship to man. It tells you the truth about man's relationship to man. About man's relationship to creation. It tells you all the truth that you need. Another thing, another resource that the Bible has for you is happiness. The world around us is... Ask people, and I know some people that have been chasing happiness for 10, 15 years. And it has taken them down a road of destruction. It's led them into sexual immorality. It's led them down paths that you would never in your imagination think that they would have allowed themselves to get involved in. But because of their pursuit of happiness, quote unquote, what the world defines as, and these are Christian folks that find themselves in the ever, never ending search for happiness. And happiness is, you know, scripture is so simple. Proverbs 8:34 says that blessed, and the word blessed, when you read blessed, like the Beatitudes, are the happy attitudes. The Beatitude, when it says blessed is the man, it means happy is the man, secure is the man. It's the same idea. But in Proverbs 8:34 it says, blessed is the man who hears me. Happy is the man who hears me. You know, when you cover up your ears and quit listening to God, you know what happens? You get unhappy. You do. You know why? Because you make stupid mistakes. You forget. And you try to. You decide, God, I'm not going to listen to you. I'm going to listen to me. And then when it's all, oh, I wonder why I'm so unhappy. Well, Luke 11:28 talks about keeping God's word and you'll be happy. Blessed are those that hear the word of God, for they will be happier. Blessed are those who keep the word of God. Something like that. Growth. So, truth, happiness are in this pot of resources that the Bible has for you. Growth. 2 Peter 3:18, but grow in grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Okay? How do you do that? What is the source of your growth? You want to get buff? You want to be, you know, like those guys? Get buff on the word. That's your source of your growth. That's your protein. That's your magic elixir. Although I don't believe in magic. It takes work. But the word is the source of growth. 1 Peter 2:2. As newborn babes desire the pure milk of the word that we may grow by it. The idea is you're supposed to be, we don't have to ask baby Juan when he's hungry. He lets us know. And when he gets a hold of that bottle, he isn't letting go until he's full. So that's the way we're supposed to be in regards to our desire to grow in God's word. Another resource, we've talked about it many times, power. We're impotent in our lives if we don't use God's word. It's the source of our power. Hebrews 4:12 talks about the word of God is living. It's powerful. It's sharper than a two-edged sword. Hebrews 4:12. The Bible provides for you guidance. Psalm 119, verse 105. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet. So when you've got your lamp, you can see where you're going. Now, if you close your lamp, it's hard to figure out where you're going. So God's word is like a lamp unto your feet. It will help you find your way. It's a lamp unto my feet, a light unto my path, is what it says in Psalms. Another resource in the pot of the Bible is comfort. And sometimes we need comfort. And Romans 15:4 talks about how Scripture can comfort you. Romans 15:4 says, for whatever things were written in earlier times were written for our learning, that we, through the patience and comfort of the Scriptures, might have hope. The patience and comfort of the Scriptures. Romans 15:4. And then the next to last one is perfection. 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17 talks about the man of God being made perfect. Okay? And the last thing the Bible has for you is victory. Okay? Victory is the source of victory. The Bible is your source over your enemy. If you use the Bible, you can defeat your enemy. Okay? And that's pretty much what we've been talking about in Ephesians. So the last of the Ephesians 6:17, the last part of it, it talks about the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. And I'll start on that. The Greek word that's used here for sword is machada. And it's not the romphia, which is a big sword. A machada is a regular size sword. It's a normal sword that a soldier would carry. And it could be used for anything. And it's not a big sword. It's a sword. We might even consider it more like a dagger. But it could be, you know, anything in this general range, and it's put on the side of the soldier in a scabbard, a holder, and it's used for hand-to-hand combat. Okay, so think about your Bible in your holster when you're in hand-to-hand combat, and that's why Paul uses that word. He doesn't use the word for a big old honking sword, like a broadsword, you know, like you got to pick it up and, you know. He uses the sword, he uses a descriptive word which describes a sword built for hand-to-hand combat, and he uses it purposefully, okay? And for this particular weapon to be used effectively, you had to train in how to use it effectively. It wasn't a sword that you just picked up and knew how to use right away. You know, when I was in the Air Force, when I was a security policeman, to graduate from police school, I had to shoot numerous weapons. I had to shoot a .38 revolver, an M16 rifle, M60 machine gun, M79 grenade launcher, and I had to, what they call, qualify with those weapons. I had to demonstrate proficiency, or they wouldn't let me out of school. Okay, this sword requires proficiency, and when it speaks of what is the source of this sword? The sword of the
Spirit.
Remember, I used the word. Was it Sunday? When I was talking about the sign gifts, I use the word pneumatos, or the word where we get pneumatics from. It's the idea is this: the source of this sword is the Spirit, and that's Paul wants you to understand that, and he uses that word. Pneumatos in the Greek, very purposefully here. And it can be, so he wants you to understand that he uses that word spiritual, so you'll understand if you have a spiritual sword, who are you, what are you fighting against?
Spiritual forces.
You're fighting against evil. You could call it carnality if you want, which isn't a bad way to think of it. I don't buy into carnal Christians because those are oxymorons. But in this instance, you could consider it the Holy Spirit against carnality, and that's why he uses that. He wants you to understand. He's speaking about a spiritual battle with a spiritual weapon that you have. You know, and what does it say? That we are what is it, Ephesians? We're fighting against spiritual wickedness, okay? That's what this sword is for. And he uses that pneumatos quite a few times in Ephesians, in the first chapter and in the fifth chapter. And the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. In the Greek, that phrase, the source and the sword of the Spirit is called a genitive of origin. Not only does it speak to what the sword is, it tells you where the sword comes from, okay? And it's perhaps a better translation, that's why I have a hard time saying this, is the sword, it is the sword. The sword in the Spirit. The sword by the Spirit might be a little bit better way to think of it. And I know those words aren't a lot different, but the idea I want you to understand is that the Spirit provides you with a sword. Like I said earlier, when I wasn't saved, I read the Bible. I read it for enjoyment, entertainment. When you become saved, you read the Bible for different reasons than entertainment or enjoyment, okay? So when you become a Christian, you receive the sword in the sense that the Holy Spirit can now teach you what the Bible means. And if you can learn what the Bible means, then you are equipped win your battles. Unbelievers, I've known unbelievers that have a lot of Bible knowledge. You know, they know the Word, but they don't know of the Word. And it's the Spirit of God that lives in the life of a believer that makes the Word alive to the believer and makes it available to them in their battles, okay? And the sword then becomes it becomes a way of our self-defending ourselves. It's a way that, and you see, I believe the more devout you become in God's, in the use of God's Word, the more dependent you become on God's Word. You know, Nikki was telling me Sunday, if I had taught what I taught here Sunday morning in my old church in Clovis, they probably would have ran me out. And I'm going to teach something else Sunday that I know they would run me out. I'm going to teach you about deaconesses Sunday morning. And it's important that you understand, first of all, what a deacon is, so that you don't go crazy on me. But the word teaches that there's female deacons. It's not an office of the church. It's a spiritual position that God puts women in. And in our own church is a very prime example of that, where we have women. If it's a God-appointed position, you know, if it was an essential to have deacons in the church, we'd be in trouble anyways. We ain't good enough. There's a vast difference between a deacon and an episcopos, who is that word really means bishop, which means overseer, which means elder. The other word, deacon, is a completely different word. The difference is the spiritual oversight that is involved in the two positions. But I'll talk about that from 1 Timothy 3. A little bit on Sunday, see if I can rile some folks up. But
so then, deacon is more of a, what are you saying?
I'm saying deacons are
spiritual leaders.
No, elders are spiritual leaders.
Elders.
Yes, there's, and that's, the biggest difference between the two is the teaching of the Word of God. Elders are to be teachers, and they can teach in a lot of different ways. Deacons don't teach, but there are people that are teachers that may not necessarily be elders. They may not have spiritual oversight. Elders are the spiritual umbrella which protects the church. That's they're the conduit through which the church, they're the umbrella which protects the church, and the conduit through which the church is connected to God. And in that conduit is the body of believers who are built around it, all functioning together to do God's purpose. The deacon oversees. What did they do in the New Testament? They were to, why did they appoint deacons?
Because of the needs of the church.
There you go. They're the worker bees. And when you look at the modern church, who are the worker bees? Well, and the problem is when the King James Bible was written, when was it written? 1600s? What was the position of women in the world? The word that is translated in 1 Timothy 3, wives, from the Greek, doesn't mean wives. It means women. And there's a big difference because it gives the qualifications of a deacon's wife. Well, if it gives qualifications for deacon's wives, why doesn't it give qualifications for elders' wives? Because it doesn't give qualifications for deacons' wives. It gives qualifications for deaconesses. Is that a word?
Yeah.
Deaconesses?
There's a deaconess that in the community and the
Priscilla?
Yeah, one of those, you know.
There was one in the church at Sisera, who's noted by Paul as being a deacon. She was a female deacon. So. But we don't have any female deacons, you know why? Because our Constitution says we won't have any. So we can't.
Where'd you get that from?
Who wrote that?
Who was that guy?
Well, see, that's why I get so upset when people will say, well, I learned it that way. Okay. You know what? That's the way I learned it, that there's no female deacon. But you know what? I have actually expanded my knowledge of the Word of God since I became saved. So the things that I have been taught, some of them, you know, there's things, I know Ron was in an elder meeting where he said, well, Steve, that's I never thought you would say what you just said, because I said something that as recent as 5, 6, 7 years ago, I would never say the words that I said at that meeting. But I believe that God's Word is a continual, the knowledge of His Word is to be continually deepening for us. It should be an experience which draws us closer and closer and closer. And I don't change my mind just to change my mind. The only reason I ever change my mind is because God shows me where I have been wrong. For me to change my mind, what happens? It means I've been wrong. So if I come to a point in Scripture where I think I've been wrong, I'm going to tell you that I think I've been wrong. And we'll let the chips fall where they may.